Oh, Christie's was a curious place to work for because it was what used to be known as a partnership, and the directors actually owned the business. They weren't appointed by shareholders. They had a percentage of the shares. It was all very simply done. There were 100 shares and about 8 directors who had anything from sort of 15 or 16% down to 1%. But in order to be a director, you had to have a share. And in order to have a share, if you were appointed or you wished to become a director, we had somehow to persuade other directors to part with a share or a part of a share. So you might, somebody might end up with 17.5, having promised that he would give you or sell you his half one share. And this meant that you couldn't really rise through the firm. You could go in as some kind of dogsbody, clerk, whatever, and do the arithmetic of the accounts and whatnot, and be frightfully efficient. But you would never get anywhere else unless the company secretary resigned, and then there would be a post, or the company auditors and so on. And of course, in the picture department, or the picture and drawings department, we had a director called Patrick Lindsay, who was the son of Lord Crawford, who ran things like the National Art Collections Fund and was a trustee of this, that, and the other thing, and hugely important in the art world. And Patrick thought that he, simply by inheritance and association, was equally important and equally gifted and so on. In fact, Patrick knew absolutely nothing about anything. He had no eye for quality. And was exceedingly difficult to work for because he was the kind of young man, he was only 4 years older than me, but with his kind of background, he felt that it was perfectly possible to wander into the great houses of the land and say, oh yes, of course that's by Caravaggio, and of course that's by Van Dyck, and did so. And having then given an attribution, which is entirely wrong, would give a valuation which was also entirely wrong. And he'd come in on a Monday morning, having spent the weekend somewhere, saying, oh, Lord so-and-so is sending his Rubens for sale. I've told him we'll put it in this, whichever sale it is. We ought to catalogue it immediately arrives. It will let me know when it comes. And the picture would arrive and I'd look at it and say, oh God, this is not by Rubens, you know. And then Patrick would come down and say, well, I've told him it's by Rubens, so you've got to catalogue it as by Rubens. Which, of course, was not what I was there for. I was there to say, this is by Rubens or it isn't by Rubens, not to tell a convenient lie for him. And it always meant that I had to go and get hold of somebody whom Patrick did respect in terms of expertise and knowledge and say, will you come and look at this Rubens and express an opinion? And then I could go to him and say, Professor so-and-so or Dr. such-and-such says that the picture is not by Rubens. With a stroke of luck, it's by a minor follower. And it isn't, you know, sort of, what do you want me to do with it now? You told Lord so-and-so. And leave him to extricate himself. Part of the procedure to which I was never privy. But that was exceedingly irksome. And occasionally he got us into such difficulties that only by the chairman of the board driving down to talk to the Marquis or the Duke or the whatever, could you actually remedy the situation? Because, and then the situation was slightly ridiculous.